Yeah, good morning all. This is M. Rajshekar. I am M. Rajshekar, working as an assistant professor in St. Martin Engineering College in the Department of Civil Engineering. I belong to the Structural Engineering Specialization. And today, I am going to deliver the lecture on the basics of strength of materials. Okay, that is nothing but the stress, strain, and the different types of stresses, different types of strains, and the stress strain diagram for mild strain. Okay, these are the contents I am going to explain now. And we know that the basic difference between the stress and strain, right? So stress is nothing but the resistance force acting per unit area, right? So the resistance force, nothing but the load, okay, acting per unit area, right? So stress is denoted by sigma, okay? Stress is denoted by sigma, and that equal to resistance force, nothing but the load, okay, which we can able to define with P, right? So per unit area, P by A. So sigma, that is nothing but the stress, right? So stress equal to the resistance force acting per unit area, right? So P is the resistance force, and this is the area of the beam or any material, right? So sigma stress we can able to define with the sigma, and the units for stress, that is load acting per unit area, right? So newton per meter, or newton per mm, or newton per meter square, or newton per mm square, or maybe anything, right? So units for stress, newton per meter square, or newton per mm square. As we know that area, that should be in mm square or meter square. So that's why the units for stress, that is sigma equal to P by A, that equal to newton per mm square. Right? So that is what the stress. Now coming to the types of stresses. And we basically there are different types of stress, and particularly two basic types of stresses are there. One is compressive stress. First one. And the second one is tensile stress. Compressive stress and tensile stress, right? So if two forces acting on the body towards it, right? Nothing but pushing, right? So if two forces are pushing a body or material towards its own axis, right? So then that particular stress, okay, whatever the amount of stress is going to be induced there, right? So that particular stress will be called as a compressive stress, right? So let me explain the name of a diagram. Right? So consider this as a material or a body, right? So if two forces acting at the two ends, right? So two forces, nothing but the loads, P as well as P, right? So if it is acting towards the material from the both the sides, right? So pushing is going to take place, nothing but the compression, right? So these two forces acting on the both sides are going to compress the material or body or a beam, right? So because of this compression, right? So whatever the stress is going to generate there, that will be termed as compressive stress. Right? So similar to this tensile stress, right? So where tensile stress is nothing but if two forces acting, okay, not towards, okay, from the body, right? If two forces acting in opposite direction of that material or body, right? So that pulling action, okay, that pulling action is going to create tension in the material. Right? So the stress here in case of pulling action, right? So where in opposite direction these are acting, then that particular stress is shown as tensile stress. Right? So tensile stress. So for compressive stress we need to call it as sigma C, and for tensile stress it is sigma E. Right? So stress is denoted by sigma, and compressive stress as well as tensile stress. And units are same. As both are the types of stresses only, right? So units are also same, newton per mm square or newton per meter square only, right? right? So this is what the basic types of stresses. And coming to the strain, right? So whenever a load is acting on a particular material or a body, right? So definitely it will subjected to some deformation. Definitely it will subjected to some deformation. Okay, strain. Now if we define the strain, okay, so whenever there is an external force acting on a body, right, so some deformation is going to take place in that particular material or body, right? So then whatever the change is going to happen to that particular body or material, right, so that particular change, right, is going to be called as a strain, right? So here also we have different types of strains, right? So longitudinal strain or lateral strain, and linear strain, or can also call it as linear strain, and volumetric strain, right? Basically we can call it as delta L by L strain, which is denoted by epsilon or E, right? So delta L by L. Delta L is change in length and L is original length. So change in length by original length, right? So this is what gives us the strain happening in a particular body, right? So if a beam which is a length of 5 meters, right? So if two forces, if a load is acting on this particular body, or else tensile forces are acting on your body, sorry, compressive forces, right? So because of the compression from the two sides, okay, so the beam length may reduce, right? So it may reduce to 4.5 meters. Okay. Now here, what is the strain? Change in length by original length. This change in length, what is the change in length? That is 0.5 meters, and by original length, that is 5 meters. Okay, the answer will give us the amount of strain happening in this particular body or medium. Right? So similarly, volumetric strain, nothing but change in volume to the original volume. Right? So volume, which is denoted by V. Okay, so epsilon V, nothing but the volumetric strain, that is delta V by V, right? So delta V is change in volume, and V is the original volume, right? So this is what the different types of strains. So tensile strain or compressive strain, lateral strain or linear strain, in two ways we can call them, and volumetric strain, change in volume to the original volume, right? So now this the units for this strain, that is going to be in mm or in meters, okay, in millimeters or meters, okay, this is going to change in the length, or volume it is going to be due to cube, right? So that is what the thing, and this diagram, right? So let me explain this diagram now. Right? So this is what this diagram represented in the stress strain curve for mild steel. As we know that in the strength of material subject, right? So each material is going to behave differently under different circumstances, right? So according to the stresses acting on it, right? So the material behaves, right? So accordingly, how the mild steel is going to behave, how the mild steel is going to behave under the application of different loads and stresses, under the application of different loads and stresses, and this is what representing the stress strain curve for mild steel, right? So here on the x axis, that is strain, and on the x axis, on the y axis, sorry, that is stress. And we know that obviously strain is a dependent one, okay, depends upon the amount of load, nothing but the stress, okay, the strain is going to take place. So that's why stress is different from strain, and strain is a dependent one and stress is the independent one. So that's why we have taken them on the x axis and y axis respectively, and let us go into this one. And here, if we are applying force, okay, if we are applying load, okay, on a particular element of mild steel, right? So how does it can bear that particular load? Okay, what will be the failure point of that particular material, right? So what are all the stages it has to go on through, right, from the starting point of application of load to the failure point, right? So let me explain through this diagram, by using this diagram, right? So this is what the stress strain curve for mild steel, and this is what the point zero from which the application of loading is going to start, right? So here from point O or zero, right? So from point O, let us consider as O, and from O to A, right? So this is up to the point A, right? So this point A, we can call it as a proportionality. Proportionality limit, and we know the Hooke's law. We know the Hooke's law, right? According to Hooke's law, stress is directly proportional to strain. So according to Hooke's law, stress sigma is directly proportional to strain, right? So stress is directly proportional to strain according to the Hooke's law. So here, up to point A, the Hooke's law is valid, right? So if we apply the force, stretch that particular material, right? So up to this proportionality limit A, right? So if we remove that particular load, right, so it can able to come back to its original position from where it has started, zero, right? So zero to A, that is linear range actually, right? So where the linear means, okay, if we remove the load, it can come back to its original position, right? Original shape of, right? So this is what the linear range, right? So point A is nothing but the proportional limit, okay? Up to point A, looks like it is where stress is directly proportional to strain, where the material can come back to its original shape or position, right? So here from point A to point B, right? So up to point B, that is elastic limit. That is elastic limit. So here on the strain zone, sir, right, on the x-axis, okay, here I have mentioned as 0.2%, right? So at this particular strain, okay, at this particular 0.2% strain, okay, every material in the universe is going to lose its elasticity. Is going to lose its elasticity, right? So up to a certain extent, okay, any material will exhibit some elastic properties, okay. Later on, if we keep on applying the load, right, so then it will possess the properties of plastic, right? So plasticity is going to take place, where the material cannot able to come back to its original position, right? So if we keep on applying the load, then automatically it will turn from elastic range to the plastic range, right? So here this point B, up to point B, some elastic properties are going to exhibit, and the amount of strain that is nothing but 0.2%, right? So the stress up to point A, that is a proof stress, okay, where Hooke's law is valid, and up to point B, the amount of stress is nothing but elastic stress, which is denoted by sigma e, which is denoted by sigma e, and this the zone between B and C, right? So this is what the zone between B and C, right? So the zone between B and C, that is called as plastic zone. That is what plastic zone, where the material becomes completely as elastic one, right? So where it cannot able to come back to its original position, all the properties are going to exhibit as a plastic one, right? So plastic zone, this BC, and this DC as well as D, right? right? So this C as well as D, that is nothing but the upper yield point, and D is a lower yielding point, right? So the portion between C as well as D, we can call that portion as a yielding zone, right? So linear range and A to B elastic zone, right? So B to C, that is plastic zone, and D to C to D, that is yielding zone. Right? So here yielding zone, and D to E, that is completely plastic zone. Sir, B is the elastic limit, and B to C, that is elastic zone. Right? So C to D, that is yielding zone, and D to E, this is what the portion where the material will becomes complete plastic, where D to E is a plastic zone, D to E is the plastic zone, right? So here always for the design purpose, okay, so if we are designing any structure, okay, what is the important point to be kept in the mind is, that is nothing but we have to design the structure up by taking care of the lower yield point only, right? So for designing purpose, right? So upper yield point as well as lower yield point, two points are there in the yielding zone for the design criteria, right? So always we need to design the stress up to upper yield point, right? So the lower yield point where the yielding, which comes to the end, right? So that's why always for the design criteria, point C, nothing but the upper yield point will be our main point, okay? Up to that point, we need to design the structure, right? So to bear the loads, right? Upper yield point, not for the lower yield point, right? So here, D is a plastic zone, right? So and again, if we keep on applying the load and it will stretch up to a point F, right? So this F is nothing but the ultimate stress. F is nothing but the ultimate stress. So maximum amount of stress, okay, the material can take, okay, after this particular point, right? So it starts deteriorating. It starts losing its motion, right? So it starts get softening, right? So this zone between E and F, the zone between E and F, this area, this portion of that particular body of the material is called as strain hardening zone. Strain hardening zone. So the distance, the weight between the plastic zone to this ultimate stress, okay, this is the ultimate stress, the maximum amount of load that a material can take, right? So that is what the ultimate stress, right? So from the plastic zone to this ultimate stress, okay, the zone between these two points, that is called as strain hardening zone, right? So next point, okay, if keeps on applying the load, okay, wherever the maximum limit has reached, okay, after that it's going to a fail, so, right? It is going to be a failure one, right? So this is the point G, which is representing the breaking point or failure point. Breaking point or failure point, this point G is representing the breaking point or failure point, right? So the zone from point F to point G, right? So here from point E to point F, that is strain softening, strain hardening zone, and from point F to point G, that is strain softening zone. Strain softening zone, right? So the point G, that is called as failure point or breaking point, right? So this is a what the stress strain curve for mild steel, where many number of elements are involved in this topic, right? So in this curve, so which is very important, okay, to study the behavior of the mild shape material, right? So how the according to the stresses, how the material is going to behave, right? So up to what point it can take the loads, right? So what is the breaking point or failure point of this particular material, right? So all these are the various elements involved in this stress strain curve for mild steel. So we have seen different types of stresses: proof stress, elastic stress, as well as ultimate stress, and similarly strain. Okay, proof strain. This is what the proof strain, 0.2% strain. At 0.2% strain, any material in the universe is going to lose its elasticity, right? So all the elastic properties are of the materials are going to be at that particular point, right? So different types of stress, ultimate stress, and different various zones also we have seen, right? So linear zone, as well as elastic zone, as well as plastic zone, yielding zone, strain hardening zone, as well as strain softening zone, right? So this is what we think about the stress strain curve for mild steel. Okay, so thank you all for giving me this opportunity.